So let me first tell you what a braid is. Imagine that you have like two wooden planks, and then there's some strings attached like, in a neat row to the first wooden plank, and then they are all tangled up. But then when they arrive to the top, they are again in a neat straight line.
Where they started, so like one goes to one, two goes to two.
Yes, so that's called a pure braid. I'll only talk about pure braids today. It doesn't hugely matter. You can also consider ones that crisscross and end up somewhere else. But let me try to draw one that actually goes back to where it started from. It goes from the bottom to the top. In between, you have some tangled mess. So when you have some big tangled mess, what's the first question that comes to mind?
How would you untangle it?
How would you untangle it, or can you even untangle it? So sometimes you have a big tangled mess and it's entirely possible to untangle it. What does it mean to untangle it? It means to make it into this braid. This is like the non-braid. So how do you untangle something? So imagine that the strands are, say, made of rubber. They are stretchy. You can move them around as much as you want. You can stretch as much as you want, but you cannot cut them. Once you cut them, the game is ruined. So the question is, if you see a tangled mess like this, can you make it into an untangle? This has some practical applications. For example, if you made this video a year ago, I had long hair. And when you braid long hair, or maybe I can show you on just this little bit. Mm-hmm. So the standard thing you do is you divide it into three parts. This will make me look rather silly. And then you do this braid. One goes over the middle one, and then the other goes over what became the middle one. And you just continue doing this until you reach the end of your hair. And then you put an elastic on it. Now, it's not two wooden planks, but at the top, it's attached to your head. And at the bottom, it's fastened with an elastic. So the top and bottom are kind of fixed, the same as in the picture that I just showed you. And the good thing about that braid is that it cannot be untangled. Because if it could be untangled, then as you move your head around, it probably would become untangled. And the one that I just drew probably cannot be untangled. For example, if you look at just the first and the last string, you can see that those are like this. They are kind of wrapped around each other in a way that you can't imagine untangling. So why is it that some braids cannot be undone? When you move the strands around, move the strings around, what's the problem that you might run into? It's that two strands catch on each other and you can't move them past each other without breaking them. So that's the main reason that some braids cannot be undone. If the strands would just go through each other magically,
like ghosts,
then any braid could be undone. This is in three-dimensional space that we all know very well because we live in it. I'm claiming that if you think of braids in four-dimensional space, then they become completely uninteresting. The main reason is that if you have two strands in four-dimensional space, they can basically go through each other like ghosts. So why is that? Let me try to give you an analogy first. So there's a little ant that lives in the plane. So this ant is two-dimensional. All it ever knew was this two-dimensional plane that it lives in. And this two-dimensional plane has a wall. The wall is one-dimensional. It's just a line in the plane. So this little ant can't go through the wall and will never know what's on the other side of the wall.
It just hits a red line.
Because it just hits a red line and it can't go through it. What happens if one day a miracle happens and all of a sudden the world of this ant becomes three-dimensional? So all of a sudden there's height. That day, the ant could just go up to the line and say, wait, but this line has no height at all. So I can just jump over it and discover the other side. So that's how, if you add a dimension, things that were uncrossable before are suddenly crossable because you can use the extra dimension to cross them.
Is that assuming that when we kick up to the fourth dimension, our hair doesn't take on an extra dimension with it?
Like, exactly, yes. Exactly. So this wall that the ant that has kept the ant on one side of its plane for its entire life, when you added an extra dimension, the wall didn't suddenly become infinitely high and two-dimensional. So that's a very good point. So let me try to show you why this ant picture is relevant to the braids and the fourth dimension. So you have a braid in three dimensions, and you can't untangle it because somewhere you have two strands that you want to move past each other, and you can't. So this is one strand, and behind it there's another strand, and you want to move it past, but you can't because it gets stuck on this strand that's in front of it.
Yeah.
So what you want to do is to move this, but it's not working. Imagine the plane in which this front strand lives. And this strand behind that you're trying to move past will only intersect that plane in one point, right? So that point will basically be the ant. So if you're just thinking of the picture that you can see in this one plane, then you have the ant, which is where the strand behind intersects the plane, and you have this other strand which lives in the plane, and that's the wall. And then when I try to move this strand behind and get stuck on this strand, that's basically the ant running up against the wall.
That becomes the hitting point of the two strands.
That becomes the hitting point. But if I add an extra dimension, now this is hard to imagine because, I mean, the braid is already in three-dimensional space. So then I have an extra fourth dimension. You can imagine that extra fourth dimension by imagining that this plane all of a sudden becomes a three-dimensional space. Okay, so if I add an extra dimension to the whole picture, then there will be an extra dimension added to this plane. So in this new space, the bottom braid can simply jump over the other strand in the extra dimension. So not in the three dimensions that it lived in before, but when you add the extra dimension, it can jump over.
Could you still braid your hair if you were a four-dimensional being? Would your hair have a new property that still made it braidable?
Well, it depends. So if I stayed the same, but I was placed in four dimensions, then no, for the reason that I just told you, because each strand of my hair is basically one-dimensional.
Your DNA would probably all fall apart as well.
Yes. But if when I was placed in four dimensions, I myself became four-dimensional and my strands of hair became two-dimensional, then I could. So I said braids in four dimensions aren't interesting, and now I will show you why they are. The key is that it's not enough to braid strings. I just showed you that if you're braiding strings, that can always be undone in the fourth dimension. So I have to show you what to braid instead.
You can braid something besides strings.
To show you that, first I'd like to show you a different way to see just regular braids in three dimensions. And since we were talking about ants, so you have some ants, and I'm making a movie in which the ants start out in a neat straight line, and then they crawl around, and eventually they get back to the neat straight line. I will film them doing this, and then there will be a whole bunch of frames. I could imagine just stacking the frames. In the first frame, I have the four ants in a straight line, and then in the second frame, they will have moved slightly. In the third frame, they will have moved again. And then so on and so forth, mm-hmm. until I get to the last frame, in which they are again in a straight line. And in between, if I trace all the ways that they had moved, what we got there is a braid. Okay, so if I make a movie of ants crawling on a plane, then that's the same as having a braid in 3D just by stacking all the movie frames on top of each other. So what does my previous statement mean in this context? So my previous statement is that braids in four dimensions are uninteresting. What would be braids in four dimensions? Well, it would be like flies flying around in three-dimensional space. And then I make a movie of the flies flying around. and I stack them on top of each other. So the fourth dimension is the time, and the frames of the movie, each frame is a three-dimensional thing because they are flying in space. So what I get is braided strings in four dimensions. So that is still uninteresting to a mathematician, for the same reason why it's uninteresting to you. Because it wouldn't hold your hand, it wouldn't hold your hair together. It can always be undone. So there's no very interesting analysis that can be done. The only point I want to get out of it is that you can think of this uninteresting object as a movie about flies. And now I can tell you what the interesting object is. Instead of making a movie about flies, you could make a movie about other things moving around in three-dimensional space. The one that I actually think about in my research is rings flying around in three-dimensional space. So if you have some rings, they start out in a straight line, and then they can fly around in three-dimensional space and eventually get back to the same position. If I make a movie about this and take all these three-dimensional movie frames and stack them on top of each other in four dimensions, I get something like a braid. So you're braiding tubes as opposed to strings. Tubes are two-dimensional. Okay? So you're braiding two-dimensional things in four-dimensional space. So why are rings more interesting than flies? I have some slightly mangled rings here. So if they just fly around, not interacting ever, they are exactly like flies and they are boring. But since they are rings, they have a hole inside. Something they can do is fly right through each other. And flying through each other, that's fundamentally different from just being flies. And that's what makes these braided tubes something interesting as opposed to just braided strings, which in four dimensions are uninteresting. So they are allowed to expand and get smaller and bigger as they need to for the purpose of flying through each other. As they fly through each other, they create the analogous kind of tangledness, kind of things that you can't move past each other.
A braid within a braid.
Yes, a tube going through another tube, which would be impossible in three dimensions. For a tube to go through another tube without intersecting it. But in four dimensions, it's possible, and it catches the same way that strings would catch on each other in three dimensions.
Can they only go completely inside each other, or can they overlap like that?
No, they can't intersect. So they are still, you know, they are. You can think of them as physical objects. Physical object, they are not phantom rings. The material doesn't go through each other. It's just the rings flying through the hole inside the other ring. This you can generalize to any dimensions. So in three dimensions, you can braid a one-dimensional string with a one-dimensional string. One dimensions with one dimensions, 1 + 1 = 2, which is 3 - 1. In four dimensions, you can braid a one-dimensional with a two-dimensional, so that's the fly when you take the trajectory in time. That is the ring when you take the trajectory in time. That's 3, and 3 = 4 - 1. You can also braid a two-dimensional with a two-dimensional, which is 4, which is bigger than 4 - 1. And similarly, in five dimensions, you couldn't braid a one-dimensional with a one-dimensional or a one-dimensional with a two-dimensional, but you could do 2 with 2 or 3 with 3, as long as dimensions of your two strings add up to at least the dimension of the containing space -1, then you can braid them together. But in my research, I mostly think about one- and two-dimensional things braided or tangled in four-dimensional space, or the simplest thing of one-dimensional things braided or tangled in three-dimensional space, and the relationships between them. So my favorite way of visualizing it is to think of it in terms of movies in three dimensions. And that is actually a little bit restrictive. Because you visualize the fourth dimension as time, and time only moves forward.